There are a ton of settings for a Victron Multiplus or Quattro, and in this video, I'm going to give you a rundown of all the most important settings that need to be changed or can be ignored for 95% of the systems we deal with here on this channel. Now, this is going to be a 101 level discussion, and I'm not going to be discussing some of the more complicated and ultimately optional features that can be programmed into the Multiplus, Quattro, or any of the other VE bus inverter chargers from Victron. Now, a few disclaimers before we get started. This channel focuses on mobile electrical systems like found in vans or RVs, so all of my recommendations are going to reflect this type of setup. To access the programming settings, you need to use an MK3 USB programming dongle connected to the Multiplus via RJ45 cable into a computer or phone with Victron Connect installed. Once connected and installed, the settings can be enabled with the password ZZZ. The specific unit used in this video for our example is going to be a Multiplus 3K 12 volt in 120 volt AC. Now, if you're using a 24 volt or 48 volt battery bank, the charging parameters are likely going to need to be doubled or quadrupled depending on the setting. And if you're in a country that uses 230 volt AC power, those settings are going to vary, but my goal is to not necessarily give you the answer, but just give you the knowledge you need to be able to find the answer yourself for your own setup. And lastly, for all of my battery charging parameters, I'm going to be using the recommended settings for battle-borne batteries. Now, there are 1,000 batteries on the market, but battle-borne batteries is our battery of choice here at explorist.life. So that's what we're going to use for the example. Now, if you're using a different brand of battery, you're going to need to reach out to your manufacturer of choice for guidance. For those of you who have purchased a battery from a marketing company instead of a battery company, and they just simply don't have the slightest clue of what any of their charging parameters are for the batteries they sell, just know that most of the battle-borne charging parameters are probably going to be the same with most any of the other batteries with built-in BMSs on the market, but proceed with caution and at your own risk. And I'm going to give you a heads up if a settings recommendation I'm making is a battery-specific recommendation. The first setting under the General tab is the system frequency. Now, this is simply the flavor of electricity, if you will, that the unit is going to put out. The United States power grid operates at 60 hertz, so we just want to match that. Now, if you're in another part of the world, you're just going to want to match the frequency of your country's power grid. So my recommendation here is to set this for 60 hertz. Next is the AC input current limit. Now, this simply tells your inverter charger how much power it's allowed to draw from shore. If you're connected to 50 amp shore power, set this to about 48 amps. 30 amp shore power, set it to about 28 amps. And 15 amp shore power, set it to 8 to 12 amps, depending on if the circuit is powering other things. Dynamic current limit is up next, and this one is best explained with an example. When you're connected to a generator, if you turn on a heavy load like an air conditioner, the inverter is going to take the brunt of the load and slowly transfer the power over to the generator, allowing the generator enough time to ramp up its RPMs to properly power the load. Turn this on, as there is no real downside to having it on in most cases. Enable battery monitor. This allows the Multiplus to act as a battery monitor, but it's only really useful when there are no DC loads, as the Multiplus only knows about the current coming through the unit. Now, since we pretty much always have DC loads in a mobile application like a van or an RV, we're just going to leave this off. If you have a stationary application, you know, just a cabin or something like that with no DC loads and a GX monitoring device in the system, this can be left on and the Multiplus can communicate its loads and charging with the other chargers in the system via VE bus. If this is a van or RV, just leave this off. The remaining three settings below this, battery capacity, state of charge when bulk finished, and charge efficiency, those are going to be grayed out whenever enable battery monitor is off, so those don't need to change for our systems. Now, if you have a system where you're going to be enabling the battery monitor, these three will need to be changed based on the batteries and the size of battery bank you have. Under the grid category, the first setting is accept wide input frequency range, which means that generators sometimes don't put out the most stable AC frequency. And this setting gives the Multiplus a little more freedom to do its best before just rejecting the incoming power. So I say just leave this on. Next is the UPS function, which allows the Multiplus to switch from shore power to battery power very quickly so that equipment connected to it will never lose power during the changeover. Now, although this is good, it also means that the Multiplus must track what the generator is doing and match the generator's efforts exactly. If the generator is putting out a distorted enough waveform, the Multiplus will not be able to match and is going to stop charging. So I just recommend leaving this off. If you have a specific item like a desktop computer or something that needs an uninterruptible power supply, simply add a dedicated UPS that would be powered by the Multiplus. Next up is the AC low and high voltage disconnect or connect. These are simply the voltages of which the Multiplus will connect and disconnect from shore power or generator based on the high or low voltage. And the defaults here are usually fine, so we're not going to change those. The inverter output voltage just tells the inverter what voltage to put out. Voltage is dependent on your location. For example, it's 120 volts for the United States, 230 volts for Australia, 120 volts for Canada, and 230 volts for the UK. So just match this voltage to your power grid, which is 120 volts for those of us here in the US. Next is a ground relay, which connects and disconnects the ground and neutral inside of the Multiplus depending on if you're disconnected from or connected to shore power. So we're just gonna leave this on for all mobile applications like campers and RVs, since we may or may not need that neutral to ground bond depending on if we're connected or disconnected from shore power. Next up is the DC input low shutdown, restart, and pre-alarm. These three settings tell the Multiplus to shut down, start back up, and alarm when the battery bank voltage gets to a certain level. My recommendation here is to program the shutdown at 11.5 volts, turn back on at 13 volts, and alarm at 12 volts. Since the BMS of a battle-borne battery will shut down at 10.5 volts, this gives us a little bit of buffer for our DC system to still function in an attempt to save a rapidly draining battery bank due to inverter overuse. Next up is the low state of charge shutdown. Now this is going to allow you to have the Multiplus turn off when the battery gets down to a specific state of charge. Now this option is only available if you're using the battery monitor features we talked about earlier. So we're just gonna leave this off in all mobile applications like vans and RVs since we're not using the battery monitor feature of the Multiplus. Next up is AES, which decreases the power consumption of the inverter by one of two methods. First off is modifying the sine wave during low power needs, or the other way is turning the inverter off and then switching back on every few seconds to search for a load. If there are no loads asking for power, the Multiplus is just going to turn back off and then turn back on and look, turn off, turn on, then look, just repeatedly. So I actually recommend turning it off. This sounds good in theory, but it's kind of unpredictable in my experience, especially when plugging something in that's really low powered, like a USB charger or something like that, as that search might not see it, and it's just kind of fiddly. Next up is Power Assist, and we are not going to talk about it here because we have made a dedicated video for it that I will leave a link to in the video description below, but we are going to leave this on. And lastly for this section is the assist current boost factor. Now this is a multiplier that tells the Multiplus how much additional power it might be asked to provide to power assist in an attempt to not overload the incoming shore power breaker. Now, if this is set too low, the shore power breaker may trip before power assist can fully do its job. And if it's set too high, the inverter will likely go into overload. And we're just gonna leave this at the default factor of 2. Next up is the charger section, which includes a lot of battery specific parameters. So here we go. Enable charger. This just toggles the charger function of the unit on and off. And my recommendation is leave it on. Next up is charge current. Now this is the maximum rate at which the charger will charge the battery bank, and this needs to be below the maximum charging rate of your battery bank. For example, a single 100 amp hour battle-borne battery has a max charging rate of 50 amps. A battery bank made from two 100 amp hour battle-borne batteries has a max charging rate of 100 amps, or 50 amps per battery. Battery bank made of four batteries, charging rate of 200 amps, 50 amps per battery, so on and so forth. So my recommendation here is all of our system designs that we have on shop.explorist.life uses enough battery bank capacity that this can simply be turned as high as it goes. Next is the absorption voltage and float voltage. And these are simply the charging voltages at which the unit will charge our batteries at. And these are going to come as direct suggestions from the battery manufacturer, which is 14.6 volts and 13.6 volts respectively, as recommended by battle-borne batteries for a 12-volt battery bank. Next is the repeated absorption interval, and this is the time frame between top-off charges if the batteries are not being used, in which the unit will just recharge up to the absorption voltage that we talked about just a second ago. I recommend putting this as 7 days, which is what battle-borne recommended to us. Next up is the maximum absorption time, which is the maximum time that the charger will stay in the absorption charging phase. And this should be set for 20 minutes per 100 amp hour of battery bank capacity, up to a maximum of 2 hours as recommended by battle-borne batteries. Next up is a repeated absorption time. Now this is the amount of time that the charger is going to stay in the absorption charging phase during a repeated absorption interval like we just talked about while topping off a battery. Now this can stay at the default of 1 hour as per battle-borne batteries. Next is temperature compensation. Now lead acid and AGM batteries need to be charged at different voltages depending on how hot or cold they are. So if you're using one of those chemistries of batteries, here is where you would enter that figure that your battery manufacturer would have provided to you. So you're going to want to turn this off when using lithium batteries. Lithium batteries are not sensitive to charging voltages during different temperatures, as long as the batteries are within acceptable charging temperatures. Next is the charge curve, and this is simply a charging voltage to charging time algorithm, and this can be set to fixed as per battle-borne batteries recommendations. Next is the lithium battery setting, which enabling this disables the temperature compensation that we've already disabled and changes the rebulk voltage offset to 0.2 volts less than the float voltage to a max of 13.5 volts for a 12-volt battery bank. Recommendation here is to turn this on. Next is storage mode, and this allows the batteries to drain even when connected to shore. And once those batteries are low enough, then shore is going to automatically kick back in to recharge to full. And my recommendation is to turn this off. If storage mode kicks in and you're ready to go use your van or your camper and you disconnect from shore power, you might be starting your trip off with a low battery, which sucks. Next is use equalization, and equalization is a tactic for renewing the capacity of a lead-acid battery by purposefully overcharging the battery, which will remove sulfate crystals from the lead plates. Now, this is not a thing with lithium batteries, so we're going to just leave this off for all lithium batteries. Next is weak AC input, and in short, this makes the Multiplus able to charge from a generator that's putting out a poor quality electrical current. So my recommendation is actually going to be to leave this off because it's a bit of a last-ditch effort to allow the Multiplus to charge from a poor quality generator, and it can cause issues. Next is stop after excessive bulk, and this simply stops the bulk charging phase in the event that a full charge is not achieved within 10 hours. And my recommendation here is going to be to leave this off because mobile electrical systems sometimes need long bulk charging cycles due to limited shore power or other DC loads using some of the charging current instead of it going into the batteries. Now the remaining two sections, AC input control and advanced, include a bunch of various features that although they're pretty cool, they're also entirely optional and a bit too advanced for this just getting your Multiplus up and running video. So we're just gonna skip over these for this 101 level lesson. Now that we're all wrapped up, here are the cheat sheets of the settings that I've recommended in this video that are consistent with a Victron Multiplus 3K and 12 volt, 120 volt AC with 12-volt battle-borne lithium batteries. Now, if you're using a different manufacturer of batteries, you can always use this cheat sheet as a guide when you reach out to your chosen manufacturer to verify proper charging parameters. Hope this video helped. We'll see you next time.